Dear students, welcome to another lecture on visual analytics. Again, a lecture that's not a mandatory part of the course, but an optional one, more research oriented. So far, we discussed many topics, many methods for visual analytics, and I used examples from a wide range of applications. Yeah, intelligence analysis, text analytics, analytics with a geospatial context, financial data. Here in this lecture, I will not describe specific methods, but I want to focus indeed on one application area, actually a very broad application area. And the reason for this is twofold. On the one hand, there is a lot of general interest in this application area. There are special conferences on visual analytics in healthcare. And on the other hand, it is a research focus in our own group. I start here with two images that show a little bit a medical context. So what you see here on the left is a typical visualization in medical applications that is an H-pyramid. Yeah? An H-pyramid means that the vertical axis here is H. Yeah, the age pyramid is divided into males and females, and even the colors are quite standardized. And you see that, in this case, this relates to a particular disease. This disease occurs quite frequently for young children, and the number of cases goes down when the children get older. Here is a slight second peak of around 20-25 years. And then this disease occurs in rather low numbers for all other age groups. That is the incidence of salmonellen, poisoning with salmonellen that occurs primarily for younger children. And there is the second slight peak here. Yeah, what do you see here? Obviously, the United States, the different states within the United States, and even smaller administrative units, the so-called counties. Yeah, the United States have 3,000 counties. And you see that a certain property is color-coded here. Yeah, that is the incidence of a disease. Yeah, color-coded according to a color scale that you see here. So this is actually, geo-visualization, so-called chloroplete maps. That means each unit is color-coded according to a certain number that is averaged for this administrative unit, in this case for a county. That is how health statistics are presented. And in the corona pandemics, you have seen similar visualizations quite frequently that tell you how the corona incidence or the corona mortality differs in different parts of a country or different parts of the world. Yeah, I mentioned already there are even special conferences or at least workshops on visual analytics in healthcare since 2010. And in our group, we make a special seminar since 2017 in the winter term on this topic. So a little bit, this lecture is a bridge between the visual analytics course and this seminar on visual analytics in healthcare. I use a few quotations that I think are really essential and useful. Ben Schneiderman, that is a hero for human-computer interaction and information visualization, spent the last years of his professional career to make progress in medical applications and in particular with respect to applying visual analytics techniques to healthcare. And this quotation here shows a little bit how he thinks about this. Interactive information visualization and visual analytics methods will bring profound changes to personal health programs, clinical health care delivery, and public health policy making. So these are actually three different pillars of the healthcare system: personal health, clinical health care, that is the hospital system primarily, and public health. That means there are authorities in every country and even internationally, that's the World Health Organization, that deal with public health, that they make recommendations, advocate policy changes in order to foster a healthier life. So the user groups for visual analytics in healthcare are clinicians, that means the persons that really treat patients, medical researchers, often with a background in statistics, that analyze large amounts of data in order to detect patterns, healthcare policymakers, often in cooperation and informed by medical researchers, but also the general public when it comes to personal health. Another quotation from Rindt, that is an Austrian author, and there was a lot of development in visual analytics in healthcare carried out particular in Austria. Medical care, in particular for chronic diseases, accumulates a huge amount of patient data over extensive periods, time periods. Yeah, if you think of a person with diabetes, for example, this person will get many, many investigations, will have many related health problems, complications. All this needs to be recorded and is potentially important for treatment decisions at a certain point in time. And of course, it's also essential and useful for medical research. There are three domains for health 2.0, as Hesse expressed it, and that relates to the Schneiderman quotation, personal health information. That means information that a person can collect related to its health state using various sensors, fitness trackers, and similar devices. There is clinical health information, primarily recorded in electronic health records. So that is very comprehensive information related to patient care. And these electronic health records are increasingly used for decision making and clinical research. When I say increasingly used, I mean the original purpose was a different one. It was primarily for billing purposes. Yeah. So the hospital, of course, wants to get refunded for their activities from the insurance companies, and for exchanging this information, the electronic health records were actually introduced. And then there is the public health information sector, with facilities and institutions at various levels. And maybe one can summarize the difference between clinical healthcare and public health in the following. Clinical healthcare is, one could say, repairing patients. Yeah, with this I mean patients are ill and acutely need treatment to improve their situation. Public health, on the other hand, has a very strong focus on prevention. That means the goal is to avoid that people get ill at all. Yeah, with fostering healthier lifestyles and enabling healthier lifestyles. Yeah. Air quality, for example, is an essential issue. As a person yourself, you can stop smoking, for example, but you cannot avoid that in the city where you live, the air quality is very bad. Yeah. So therefore, measures also on a political level needs to be taken. Another focus of public health is also to carefully think about and investigate measures for the early detection of diseases in order to detect them early and treat them early if this is really probably successful, if this is promising. So for example, cancer screening for frequent cancer types like colon cancer. Yeah, there was a lot of medical research necessary in order to understand where is a certain measure probably successful. If a disease cannot be cured at all, it does not help to detect the disease early. Yeah, if a disease can develop very fast, then early detection measures are also not promising because you cannot go every week to cancer screening. Yeah, but for example, for colon cancer, certain investigations need to be carried out every 5 or every 10 years. Yeah, and if then no precursor of cancer was found, you can be quite relaxed, because the likelihood that you develop this kind of cancer within the next 5 to 10 years is really very low. Yeah, so this is now something that is taken for granted, but it was a huge achievement of medical research based on large amounts of data, clinical trials, and so on. I would admit that these three areas are not completely disjunct. They partially overlap, and Hesse also acknowledged that they partially overlap. The target users, of course, are different for these three areas. Most of the research and development that was carried out focuses more on clinical health care. Yeah? And since this is the case, also in this video lecture, I focus a little bit more on this area. Also, I have personally a lot of sympathy for public health information and public health care. And also did research myself in this area. Yeah, what actually is patient data? It describes patient conditions, so all diagnostic measures that were applied to a patient, biopsies, for example, other diagnostic tests, the heart function was tested, that all is represented in patient data with the specific time when this occurred. And also treatment. Yeah, patients were prescribed a drug starting from a certain date, ending at another date. So treatment could be something that happens immediately, like surgery, or something that has a certain interval in time, a certain duration. Measurements derived from blood samples or urine samples are also essential patient conditions represented in patient data. Patient data is inherently time dependent. Yeah? The state of the patient changes over time. Diseases may develop, may be cured. So that needs to be represented. And the patient data is analyzed to understand how treatment decision affected the patient state on different time scales. Yeah? So imagine that a patient has cancer. And after an initial treatment that was successful, the cancer reoccurs and again treatment decisions have to be taken, then of course you would try to understand, was there already a chemotherapy applied to this patient? Could the patient really tolerate this chemotherapy, or had the patient severe side effects? Maybe we should use another drug for chemotherapy or adapt the dose. Yeah, so that is what I mean about understanding previous treatment decisions and their effects. So that's patient data. Yeah, and that is more important for clinical health care. For public health, there is often cohort study data used. Cohort studies mean healthy participants are invited to take part in a health survey. They get questionnaires with many questions related to their lifestyles. You see some examples. Also, some tests are applied to them. So, for example, blood and urine samples typically are also analyzed for this cohort, for cohort study data. And this investigation is repeated over time. Yeah. So, for example, in Northeast Germany, there is a large study that started in 1997. Social health in Pomerania with a few thousand participants. And after 4 to 5 years, these examinations were repeated so that one can understand how these participants developed over time. You may recognize that I avoid the term patients here, because most of these persons are not ill. Yeah, and at least that was not the reason why their blood was analyzed, for example. It was for this research purpose here of understanding trends in health. So also here we have time-dependent data, but I used the term that is a bit debatable. The data is more static, and with this I mean that there is a rather large gap between the points in time where we record the patient state. Yeah, so that's important for some visual analytics techniques and visualization techniques, they are quite different when I have a continuous time scale with many rapid changes, or whether I have, for example, data of a patient with 3 or 4 points in time where there is a large gap in between. An essential aspect of cohort study data is that the members here, the participants, are randomly chosen. Yeah? The goal is not only to have a rather large number of participants, because every kind of statistical analysis is not robust if you have only a few participants, but it should also be representative. Yeah? If, for example, you only would have people that live in cities and have a very high education status, then you get a different picture of the state of the health state of the population compared to a rural population with a rather low educational background. Yeah. So therefore, age, gender, social status, that is balanced with respect to this. Yeah, patient and cohort study data comprise numerical values, categorical values, often even binary values, so yes or no, smoker or not smoker, married or not. And the visual representation of this data, of course, has to take into account these different data types. The patient data is not perfectly in the sense that you can rely on the fact that the same number always means the same. What do I mean with this? Imagine you want to compare blood pressure measurements. Yeah, blood pressure is quite important as a risk factor for cardiovascular diseases. Yeah, different nurses or different physicians would measure the blood pressure slightly differently. Yeah, and also the state of a person differs slightly depending, for example, on the hour of the day. Yeah, so for one person under different conditions, different times of the day or different nurses, you would get slightly different blood pressure measurements, and that makes it difficult to use this data. It is not perfectly reliable. In cohort study data analysis, these effects are reduced as much as possible. So there are very careful instructions how the nurses that are involved should measure the blood pressure. Yeah, and if you think of image data, that is more and more also included in such examinations, like magnetic resonance imaging, which involves no radiation, so that's more suitable for cohort study data than CT with the radiation that's involved. Yeah, but for the same patient, different MRI scanners would lead to slightly different imaging results. Yeah, and an MRI scanner, yeah, the hardware does not change so much over time. Even there are some physical effects that change it. The coils also age, but that is a rather slow process. But what may change faster is the software that is used. Yeah, there are so-called protocols and sequences that actually define which pulses are applied in a certain sequence. And an MRI scanner, like your laptop, often wants to get updated because there are newer protocols and sequences. They are more efficient, for example. Yeah, but if you do this, then of course the data is slightly different and the comparability of the results suffers. Yeah, so for such a cohort study, there are no updates of protocols and sequences of an MRI scanner, for example, for a rather long period of time. Yeah, such a wave takes a few years and nothing is allowed to be changed in order to make it comparable. Yeah, so that's what I mean when I say here cohort study data is to a larger extent comparable. Yeah, in clinical healthcare, you do not care for these problems. And to some extent, that's okay, because you want to treat the individual patient and the focus is not on comparing many patients over time. But here for cohort study data, that's quite essential. Cohort study data, however, has also some unique problems in data quality. There is a lot of self-reported data. Yeah, people are asked about their drinking habits, about their smoking habits, and others. Yeah, and you may imagine that people, on the one hand, cannot perfectly reliably answer some questions. So if you ask people how much alcohol they drink in a week, yeah, they do not measure it. Yeah, that's an estimation. But even if they estimate as good as they can, maybe their answer is systematically driven in the one or other direction. So here you can imagine people typically would say that they drink less alcohol than they actually do. Yeah. If you compare the number of alcoholic drinks that are sold with what people say how much alcohol they drink, you have to assume that most alcohol is sold to somebody but then wasted. No one admits to have drunken it. Yeah. And that is true for a number of this self-reported data. Medical researchers have some facilities in order to detect at least to some effect, to some extent, these effects and compensate it, but there remains some uncertainty. Yeah, a few further quotations from Hund et al. Within such patient data, relevant and interesting structural or temporal patterns, and he uses the term knowledge here, are often hidden and not directly accessible to domain experts. The concepts of relevant and interesting are not crisply defined and inherently dependent on context and subjective judgment. Yeah, so what are challenges here that arise for visual analytics? Timely information should be offered in the right format. What does this mean? Often graphical summaries are useful, overviews and facilities to specify your own interest in subset of the data and to focus on that. Team decision making should be supported. In one other video lecture, I described the topic of cooperative visual analytics, and that's relevant here as well. Yeah, medical teams with different specialities can be involved, a large display can be involved, people sit in front of this and discuss, maybe using personal devices for making notes and sharing private views. Another challenge is to characterize and understand similarity, primarily similarity between patients. So it could be quite useful if you have a patient where the treatment decision is difficult to look in the database of the hospital for similar cases that were in the past treated in this hospital and to think about, to look for the outcome based on some treatment decisions that could give you a hint on what is an appropriate decision for this patient in this moment in time. So, and first you look for similar patient and then you want to compare, of course, the effectiveness of treatments. Was a treatment effective or not? And what actually was probably the reason for why a treatment was effective or not? Yeah. So what is the causal relationship there? A data structure and even a visual representation that can be used here is a causality graph. Yeah, different measures of the patient, diagnostic measures and treatment outcomes are related in a graph that is semi-automatically created. It definitely needs input from the user. Yeah, risk and uncertainty is basically important in all kinds of medical decisions, in medical assessments on the clinical level, but also on the public health level. Yeah, if you use visual analytics systems for epidemic modeling and trying to understand how pandemics will develop in the future, you make a number of assumptions, and these assumptions are not absolutely clear. You have to guess to some extent, and based on these assumptions, you come to different predictions, and that should be conveyed as well. Yeah, and another challenge relates to the evaluation. Yeah, in particular, if you develop visual analytics systems that are supposed to be used in clinical healthcare, then they should also be evaluated in this setting, yeah, in the wilderness, as Ben Schneiderman would say, not in the clean situation of a lab where the physician is not interrupted and has the time that he wants to have, but really in the situation where the physicians have many activities and duties to be accomplished in a rather short periods of times with a ringing telephone and other distractions. Visual analytics in healthcare involves particularly sensible data, so therefore data protection is of course essential. Data needs to be processed in anonymized form, at least if it's used for research. Yeah, in case of clinical healthcare and the individual treatment decisions for one patient, there of course it needs to be absolutely clear that we know who is the patient that we want to operate tomorrow. Special care is also needed, even if data is anonymized, if some rare features or rare diseases would allow to identify a person. Yeah, so then even further measures have to be taken in order to avoid that health data can be associated with a particular patient. Yeah, so after all this, I come to the outline of this presentation on visual analytics in healthcare. I want to start with discussing decision support for clinical treatment focused really on single patients. So that means we have to graphically display the patient state, use this for designing about treatment plans, monitoring how well the treatment plan is actually applied and fulfilled. That is the first topic. Later we discuss visual exploration of multiple patients, so that we can analyze a group of patients and look for patterns that arise there. That involves a number of interesting questions. So for example, how to align patient histories over time. So certain events then should be used as alignment, for example, the diagnosis of a particular disease, and then we can look back in the patient history and look forward what happened before this diagnosis, what happened after this, or the moment when the patient was sent to the intensive care unit, what happened before and after. So there are different strategies how to align multiple patients, and alignment is a basis for making them comparable. Visual exploration of multiple patients still is focused on this clinical situation. Visual analytics of cohort study data, in contrast, is more the public health area. I want to briefly discuss hypothesis-based analysis of such data, but also, and you know from previous video lectures, that this is the major, I would say even the major motivation for visual analytics, to contribute to generating new hypotheses, and then of course to further confirm and validate and test these hypotheses. I want to present one specific topic first, because there are a few solutions that I think are actually quite smart and quite interesting to talk about, not developed in our group, unfortunately. But also because the underlying clinical problem is indeed a very severe one, and that is adverse drug effects. Yeah, very often patients get drugs prescribed, very often not only one drug, but several drugs that interact with each other. Patients often have not only one disease, but several diseases, in particular if they are old. And in particular, if they are old, they cannot tolerate drugs very well. Yeah, so that leads to adverse reactions that can be more or less severe, that can be so severe that they actually kill the patient. And it's essential to record this, and there are standardized systems how that has to be recorded and analyze it and trying to understand what is really a good strategy to prescribe drugs with only low or at most moderate risks for adverse drug effects. Yeah, and finally, some thoughts on visual analytics for public health, focused also on epidemic modeling. So that would involve also COVID-19. I prepared these slides a few years before COVID-19 occurred. And another topic that I briefly want to discuss in this area is prevention of injuries. And finally, and that goes more in this personal health information, I want to very briefly look into patient information and comparison. So this relates to systems that have the patient as target users, not medical specialists, public health experts, but indeed the general public, the patients. So I think these are the last quotations that I want to give here, that as an input for the decision support for clinical treatments. Physicians are confronted with increasingly complex patient history based on which they must make life-critical decisions, in particular in a hospital. Yeah? Clinical researchers are eager to study the growing databases of patient histories to detect unknown patterns, ensure quality control, and discover surprising outcomes. Again, this is from Rind and colleagues, a paper that I already cited before, a survey on visual analytics in healthcare, not quite up to date meanwhile, yeah, 2013, but quite interesting to read with a good overview, structure, taxonomy of research in visual analytics in healthcare. Yeah, and I want to quote again Ben Schneiderman. The increasing data in electronic health records challenge the physician's capacity to grasp an overview of the patient history while seeing specific data that alert them to potential problems. Yeah, that would be very desirable if a physician immediately can see certain things that are critical for a particular patient, that are maybe also unique for a particular patient. That means where the general routine that a physician, of course, has with treating patients with a certain disease probably needs to be changed because of a specific situation here. And if I can tell you one thing really as a general experience from thinking about patient treatment, patients in many, many aspects are different. They are individual. That starts with anatomic variations, variations in physiology, variations in their psychological state. Yeah, so a good medical treatment really has to take into account many traits and aspects of the individual patient. So the target user groups here are physicians and researchers when we think about decision support for clinical treatment. So I mentioned already this term electronic health record, or an alternative term that's also used as electronic medical record several times. Let me describe this data structure a bit more. It is a data structure that was designed primarily because of administrative, regulatory, financial and legal needs. Yeah. So information that is necessary to collect and make sure that it was collected for legal reasons, so that no one can say the physician made a mistake. For administration, that means, for example, cancer is an example for a disease that is regularly collected in cancer registries. So if there is information that a hospital is obliged to represent and to send to a general registry, that is also represented here. And financial needs means primarily this billing process that a hospital sends information to the insurance company and wants to get refunded for treating a patient after carefully documenting which treatments actually have been applied. Yeah. It's a quite complex data structure with laboratory values, also scores. Yeah. So for example, patients get a number of questions to assess their mental ability. Yeah. And that is summarized as a score, an ordinal value. And there are symptoms and diagnosis. All of this is summarized in electronic health data. That is highly standardized. That is good for using this data also for research. So there is a consistent use of terms, and computer systems also enforce a consistent use of terms because they prepare lists of possible options instead of free text entry, where all kinds of mistakes could occur. How a disease is characterized, that's highly specified. There is the International Statistical Classification of Diseases and Related Health Problems, ICD. The current version is 10 for this. Decision making is based on the patient status, of course, symptoms, the medical history, treatments that were applied in the past. So for example, a cancer patient cannot get one radiation treatment planning after the other because there is so much radiation involved that severe side effects would be almost guaranteed if you would do this 2 years later again, and ongoing treatments. The data is potentially distributed also over several databases, and then of course integration of this data is essential. Tailored user interfaces are important for electronic health care. For research, basically these systems were not designed primarily for research. So if I think of my medical cooperation partners, they often have to extract in a quite cumbersome process data from these electronic health records, then they copy them often in Excel tables, and then they use Excel for their analysis. It's not directly integrated. Often textual analysis is even carried out. Query languages are available, that's true, and there is also a special variant of SQL, the medical SQL, that's tailored to medical applications. The exploration of electronic health records is related to some very typical questions. You can try to analyze them with respect to what are typical sequences of diagnostic steps, medication, other types of treatment related to a particular disease. And you will certainly find that for a particular disease, there are different sequences, and that raises the question how these different sequences relate to an outcome. Are there sequences that are typically more favorable than others, or is this only affected by the patient state, which was initially already more favorable for some group of patient compared to others? Clinical treatment is guided to a strong extent by clinical guidelines. Leading medical researchers meet in all areas, in all medical specialities, every 5 year, every 6 year or so, in order to update guidelines for treating stroke patients or patients with a vascular disease, for example, using all the scientific evidence that occurred meanwhile. These guidelines are often not very strict and very precise, for a good reason. The physician that actually treats the patient needs some flexibility to adapt the treatment on the one hand to the situation in a particular hospital. The equipment is not the same in all hospitals. Also on personal capabilities and also to the specific patient. But nevertheless, the guidelines give orientation and also have some mandatory parts even in it. So therefore, it's also essential to understand, follows the treatment actually these guidelines? And if not, what are typical deviations? And maybe there are good reasons for deviations from the guidelines. Maybe the guidelines in certain situations are just not applicable, and how this relates to the outcome. And also I saw a number of research attempts that look for unusual sequences in electronic health record data. That means the events that occurred there are unusual. For example, a patient comes to the hospital. That's not unusual. The disease is quite severe and he needs to be transferred to the intensive care unit, ICU. That's also not unusual. The state of the patient could be improved and the patient cannot leave immediately the hospital, but he can be sent back to a normal bed. And then comes the unusual part. Only a few days later, the situation of the patient has worsened again to such an extent that he needs to be sent back to the intensive care unit. Yeah. Was there a problem that caused this? Was it a mistake to send the patient back to the normal room? Or is this something that was inherent in the disease, that this could not have been predicted and avoided? Yeah, that could be a research question for an unusual sequence of events. Yeah, so let me describe to the relation to visual analytics here. What is the relevant data? Let me describe this a bit more in detail. We have point data, point events, and interval events. A point event would be something like, for example, the patient received surgery. Of course, the surgery does longer than a very brief moment in time. It may last 4 hours, but that's not important. Yeah. So the time scale at which we look at the patient history is such that we say that is a point event, an event without duration. An interval event is something that has a start point and an end point. For example, the duration of a hospital stay or the duration of a stay in the intensive care unit. Yeah. There is other time-oriented data that does not have this event character. That means we have more continuous values over time. So, for example, at the intensive care unit, there are a number of measures characterizing the patient state that are continuously acquired over time. Yeah, so that is also represented and needs appropriate visualization. Yeah, we need visualization of event type data for these point and interval events. We need visualizations of other time-oriented data. You may immediately think of timeline-based visualizations. Yeah, that's certainly the most typical way to represent time-dependent data, but it's not the only one. Yeah, there are other variants and other alternatives. A calendar-based view, for example, is slightly different. Yeah, the calendar is typically displayed in days of the week, so you have rows and columns. It's a matrix-like visualization that could also be appropriate. We will see that there is also a need for multi-dimensional visualization techniques such as glyphs, yeah, or even composite glyphs that can summarize a number of variables characterizing the patient state. Yeah, and for some public health problems, spatiotemporal visualizations are essential. I showed you in the beginning of this video lecture an image of the counties of the United States. So you want to understand how something is spatially distributed. And often you don't want to look only at one point in time, but you want to understand how things develop over time, which differences occur and how these differences, again, are different for different regions. So I mentioned ICD, and I want to explain this here a bit more in detail. That is the standardized representation of diseases. I mentioned here ICD-9 before. I said the current version is ICD-10. The basic structure, however, has not changed. I suppose what has changed in ICD-10 is just that there are a few more categories and diagnose groups and actual diagnosis and codes. Why I assume that this gets a bit more? Well, with more and more research, the understanding of diseases gets more and more specialized. Yeah. So this categorization and representation of diseases is based on a hierarchy. So here in this part of the hierarchy, the top level node is called cardiac disorders. Yeah. So there are 38 different categories. One of these 38 is cardiac disorders. And for these 38 cardiac disorders, there are hierarchical condition categories, in this case 195 groups, not only for cardiac disorders, for all the 38. Yeah. So a few of them relate to cardiac disorders from 80 to 94, so 15 of these HCC codes. And these are further subdivided in diagnosis groups in diagnosis and in ICD codes. That's the lowest level here. So for example, here is one diagnosis group 428 and 41 ICD codes relate to this 428 at this level of the hierarchy. Such a hierarchy is a useful thing because it allows to filter at different levels. Yeah? You may be interested first in tell me about all patients with cardiac disorders, and maybe the search result that you get then is too extensive, too large. Then you may further subdivide this search result based on the HCC code, yeah, or based on the DX group. So, and as at the end for this video lecture, I want to discuss another data structure that is quite essential, and we will see in the next video lecture how this will be actually used. That is the treatment plan. Yeah. So we have on the one hand the patient state characterized by many variables that change over time. And then there are treatment plans. A treatment plan has an intent. That means what we want to achieve. We want to reduce the blood pressure from 160 to 140, for example. Yeah. So an intent is the first thing. Then a treatment plan has conditions when it can be applied. Yeah. The related part of a treatment plan is there are also terminal conditions when the application of the treatment plan should be stopped, either because we have achieved our intent, that would be the fortunate situation, or because something happened that is so severe that we cannot just continue the treatment. Yeah. For example, a complication arises, a side effect that's very severe, so we cannot continue chemotherapy or radiation treatment, at least not in the way as we originally planned it. Maybe we have to adapt it and reduce the load on the patient here. Treatment plans may also be hierarchical, like the ICD group. That means we have an overall treatment plan and sub-plans. Yeah? That's also a good strategy to make the complexity that the treatment plan may have more manageable. Also, treatment plans are temporal. That means drug prescriptions or chemotherapy have a temporal character. So it is clearly specified in the initial decision how often for a certain period of time the patient will receive chemotherapy. And also these treatment plans are more and more available in a digital manner, which makes it possible, of course, to analyze them with visual analytics techniques. Yeah? So treatment plans are analyzed together with the patient state in order to understand the effect of treatments. Yeah, with this, I want to close this first video lecture on visual analytics in healthcare. Thanks a lot for your attention.